Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the ninth video in the STM32 ADC series, and today we will continue exploring the ADC peripheral. In the previous videos of this series, we have covered how to read single and multiple channels of the ADC. We have also covered the injected conversions in the recent videos of this series. Today we will see how to use the oversampling to increase the resolution of the ADC. Oversampling can be incorporated to increase ADC resolution past the currently available number of bits. This can help reduce the cost in building a system by utilizing lower resolution ADCs to oversample a signal and obtain a higher resolution result. You can read more about the oversampling in the application note, AN5537. I will just cover some important points mentioned in the hardware sampling section of this note. I have got a new device from Active Firmware Tools. This is a logic analyzer cum debugger, which can be used as an oscilloscope and as a firmware debugger too. I will use this device to generate the sinusoidal signal, which the STM32 will read. Then the STM32 will send the digital data to this device, which will be graphed on this device itself. I am still testing this device, and once I finish exploring it, I will make a video about it too. I will leave the link to the product in the description, do check it out if you are interested. I am using Nucleo L496 for today's video, and here is the connection diagram. The output pin from the Active Pro carries the sinusoidal signal, and it is connected to the pin PA3 of the board. This is basically the ADC pin. This output pin is also connected to the analog input of the Active Pro, so that we can visualize the sinusoidal signal. The debugger can be connected using the SPI, therefore these two pins are used for half duplex SPI connection. Alright, let's start the Cube IDE and create a new project. I am using the Nucleo L496 development board for this video. My regular boards F103C8 and F446RE do not support the oversampling. The H750 do support it, but things are very straightforward in it. Therefore, I decided to use this L496, as it will help us understand the topic more clearly. Let's start with the clock setup first. This board does not have an external high-speed crystal, so let's use the multi-speed internal RC oscillator itself. I will run the system at maximum 80 MHz clock. Alright, let's enable the ADC now. I am using the pin PA3 of the MCU, which is ADC1 channel 8. Let's configure channel 8 in single-ended mode. Before we configure this further, let's go back to the clock configuration. The ADC is running at 40 MHz, but I need it to run at 64 MHz for better explanation of the oversampling. So let's configure the PLL to make it 64 MHz. Alright, the ADC clock is at 64 MHz now, and if we use the prescaler of 64, it will come down to 1 MHz. Let's configure the resolution to 6 bits for now, so that we can understand the importance of higher resolution later. I am only using one channel in the continuous mode, so let's enable the continuous conversion mode. We also need to enable the DMA continuous request, but let's configure the DMA first. Here I am configuring the DMA in the circular mode, so that the data can be transferred continuously. Note that I am setting the data width to half word, that is 16 bits, even though the ADC is configured with 6 bits resolution. I am going to change the resolution later, so this setting will remain unchanged. Now enable the DMA continuous request. We will not configure the oversampling for now. Let's configure the sampling time for channel 8. Here is the reference manual of the L496. Under the ADC programmable resolution, you can see the sampling time for different resolutions. For the 6 bits resolution, the ADC takes 6.5 clock cycles to convert the result. Now if we use the sampling time of 47.5 cycles, the total time taken by ADC to sample and convert the result would be 54 microseconds. We will see this on the analyzer. Let's set the sampling time of 47.5 cycles. As I mentioned, I am using the Active Pro Analyzer and Debugger to debug this application. The device can work with the SPI, so I am configuring the SPI in half duplex mode to transmit the data to the debugger. I am going to use the DMA for data transfer. I am also going to toggle a pin, which will help us measure the ADC conversion time. Therefore, the pin PD7 is configured in the output mode. Alright, that is all the configuration we need, so click Save to generate the project. Let's build the project once. We will first define a 16-bit variable to store the ADC raw data. Now inside the while loop, start the ADC in the DMA mode. The converted data will be stored in the variable we just defined, and we are converting only one channel. Once the ADC finishes the conversion, an interrupt will trigger, and the conversion complete callback will be called. Inside this callback, we will toggle the pin PD7, and then set the variable done to 1. Now inside the while loop, we will check if the variable is done is set to 1. If it is, we will send the ADC value to the debugger, and then reset the variable to 0, so that this loop can only run when the ADC has finished conversion. Alright, let's build and flash the project to the board. This is the software for the Active Pro debugger and logic analyzer. This is the output section, and here I am configuring channel 1 to output the sine wave. I am setting the maximum voltage to 1.1 volts, so that there will be less variation in the voltage. Here you can see the data sent by the STM32, the toggling pin PD7, and at the bottom we have the feedback from the Active Pro itself. Let's see the toggle time first. You can see the pin toggles every 54 microseconds, which is exactly the same as we calculated. The maximum voltage is reaching around 900 millivolts, which is less than expected. It might be due to some wiring issue, but let's continue anyway. Now since we are using 6 bits resolution, there are less number of values available for the voltage variation. Therefore you will see this line remains horizontal for a lot of the time. In fact the voltage at this point is around 168 millivolts, whereas it is around 268 millivolts at the end of the horizontal line. So for almost 100 millivolts, the line remained horizontal at the value 2. Similarly, the line is horizontal for other values as well. The STM32 reference voltage is set to 3.3 volts by default, therefore for the 1.1 volts the maximum value we can get is 1/3 of the maximum value. So we have seen how in the low resolution, the ADC is not able to differentiate between small voltage variation. Let's configure the resolution to 12 bits now. We will keep the other configurations unchanged. Now we are using 12 bits resolution, so the conversion time will change. The ADC takes 12.5 cycles to convert the 12 bits resolution. If we keep the sampling time the same as the previous value, we should now get the result every 60 microseconds. Let's generate the project again. We will keep the code unchanged, let's build and flash it to the board. Let's run the debugger again. Here you can see the flat lines are gone now. Since there are more values available for the ADC, it can show variation for even small changes in the voltage. The pin toggling time is 60 microseconds, which is the same as we calculated. I have fixed the wiring now, and here you can see the maximum value we are getting is around 1350. As I mentioned, the STM32 reference voltage is 3.3 volts by default, and therefore the input voltage of 1.1 volts is equivalent to the 1365. we are getting almost the same value here. Our curve looks better than before now, and the ADC values are updating as per the analog signal. Now let's imagine I want an even higher resolution, higher than 12 bits. This is where the oversampling comes in. Here we have the option to enable the oversampling, so let's enable it. The oversampling ratio decides how many samples we want for each trigger. Let's take a look at the application note again. This note is specific to STM32L4 devices, but the same logic works for all the STM32 devices as well. There are only a few differences, and we will see them too. We know that the number of bits increases after oversampling. In some of the STM32 devices, the oversampling engine keeps the 16 least significant bits after the shifting, and rounds the result of the removed bits. The size of the ADC data register in such devices is 16 bits, therefore a higher number cannot be stored into this register. But devices like the H750 have an ADC data register, which is 32 bits wide, therefore we can store even higher resolution results in it. We will see it at the end. Here in the CubeMX, you can see the oversampling ratio of 32 to 256 is grayed out. Let's understand it in the application note. This formula here gives the bit depth after the oversampling. Here X represents the bits on which the samples are accumulated at, N represents the oversampling ratio, and M denotes the bit shift. For example, if we accumulate the samples at 12-bit resolution, and the oversampling ratio is set to 32 without any bit shift, the resulting resolution will be 17 bits. Now as I mentioned, the ADC data register in L496 is only 16-bit wide, hence storing 17 bits in the data register is not possible. Therefore we need to shift the bit by 1, which will result in 16 bits resolution. Similarly, if we use the oversampling ratio of 64, it will result in 18 bits resolution. Therefore we need to shift the bits by 2, which can result in 16 bits resolution. As you can see, these ratios are blocked right now. But if we enable 1-bit shifting, the ratio of 32 gets unlocked. Similarly, if we enable 2-bit shifting, the ratio of 64 gets unlocked. So without any bot shifting, an oversampling ratio of 2 will result in 13 bits, 4 will result in 14 bits, 8 will result in 15 bits, and a ratio of 16 will result in 16 bits. At this moment, if I shift the bits by 4, the resolution will be 12 bits as shown in the calculation. But I am keeping it at 16 bits. Also note that I am not modifying the ADC clock, we will first see how it works out with this configuration itself. There are no changes required in the code, let's build and flash the project to the board. Here you can see now we have the maximum values ranging up to 19,500. Let me change the output voltage to 3.3 volts here, and we will capture the data again. Now we are getting the maximum values of around 62,000. This means the resolution is now 16 bits. You can also observe the curve is smoother than before, and we have less jitters in the data. Let's check the ADC conversion time. The time is around 960 microseconds, although we were getting 60 microseconds in 12 bits resolution. So what happened? Like I mentioned, for the oversampling ratio of 16, the ADC will take 16 samples for each trigger. Basically, the conversion starts as soon as the previous conversion is over. For a single sample, the ADC is configured to take 60 microseconds, and therefore for 16 samples, it will simply take 16 times the more time, hence 960 microseconds. In simple words, The oversampling by a ratio of 16 reduces the sampling frequency by a ratio of 16. So to maintain the sampling frequency at the previous rate, we need to either increase the ADC clock by 16 times, or reduce the channel sampling time, so that the resultant change would be the increase in sampling frequency. I will simply reduce the prescaler to increase the ADC clock. Since the oversampling ratio is 16, I am reducing the prescaler by 16 times, so that the ADC clock can increase 16 times. Alright, now we will test the project with this configuration. Let's capture the data again. You can see we still have the 16 bits resolution. Also, the pin is toggling every 60 microseconds. That means we have the same sampling frequency, which was prior to the oversampling. Let me change the voltage back to 1.1 volts, and capture the data again. We are now getting the maximum value of around 19,000, which is near one-third of the maximum 16-bit value. But note that the output data still has jitters, even at this resolution. Now this may be due to a lot of reasons, but I am assuming one of them could be the resolution. We will now see how to use even the higher oversampling ratio. Let's open the Cube MX again. I can only reduce the prescaler by a factor of 4 now. So I am going to use the oversampling ratio of 64, and to do so, I need to use the bit shift of 2. This will result in a resolution of 16 bits again, but now we are taking 64 samples instead of 16 samples. Alright, let's test the updated project again. Here you can see the output data has less jitters now, but the maximum value is a bit lesser than what we were getting before. It can happen as there are a lot of samples being averaged to get these values. Although the resolution is still 16 bits. Also note that the sampling time is the same, 60 microseconds. So we saw how the oversampling increases the resolution, and it makes the output more uniform. But it rescues the sampling frequency, therefore the frequency needs to be increased by the same factor, which is used for the oversampling. Let's take a quick look at the reference manual of the H750. Here, open the ADC register map. You can see the ADC data register is 32 bits in size, therefore the oversampler here will not have restrictions like we saw in case of L496. Let's check out the oversampler section under the ADC functional description. As mentioned here, we can use the oversampling ratio from 2 to 1024. Even if we accumulate the oversampling results on the 16-bit data, we can reach up to 26 bits resolution with the ratio of 1024, without any bit shift. Storing 26 bits is still possible for the data register as it is 32 bits wide. We can also use the bit shifting to reduce the resolution as per our requirement. The rest of the processing will remain the same as we discussed in case of L496. Whatever microcontroller you are using, it will either have the data register 16 bits or 32 bits wide. So the usage of the oversampler will vary as per the width of the data register. I hope you understood how to use the oversampling to increase the resolution of the ADC. This is it for the video. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.